any process in the world requires three things. A process requires ground, it requires goal, and it requires tools, instruments, right? So for me, leadership is just these three things: self-belief, having a vision, and inspiring people around that. Your self-image is mainly a function of who you think you are. So every time that fear came up, what I did is to just stay with it. I mean, I call it as staying in the fire of the feeling. To very early on, understand and practice the skill of deep listening.
Okay, so today we have with us Krishna Iyer. Krishna is fusionier of technology, consciousness, and business. So he has held executive positions, including that of a CEO at software companies, and is currently an angel investor, advisor, and executive coach to conscious startups. And he's a chartered accountant and holds international certifications in technology and communication. Krishna's IT career of around more than 20 years had various organizations such as Capgemini. Capgemini provided him living and working experience in Europe, Asia, North and South America. And a significant part of his IT career was spent as a co-founder and CEO at Go Live Faster, predictive analytics and QA firm that primarily worked with US banks. He has facilitated visioning and strategy sessions for top leadership teams of various organizations. He had spoken at several global conferences and has addressed a varied audience, including executives at top Indian companies, engineers at Microsoft Seattle, students at IIT Delhi, bankers in the United States, and spiritual seekers in Asia, Australia, and America. His forte lies in facilitating business simulations and game-based learning. He's a trainer and facilitator as Wisdom Solutions, through which he has facilitated leadership and thinking skills workshops for Fortune 500 companies and who's who in India. So welcome, Krishna, to this show, and thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Rohan.
And as I shared with you, this show is focused on, you know, leadership lessons, learning through real life stories. So,
yes.
So tell us a bit about, you know, your personal life journey beyond all this, these qualifications and accomplishments.
Thank you, Rohan. I was privileged to be a part of a movement, a spiritual movement, very early in my age, which gave me a lot of opportunities for public speaking, leadership, etc. And so that also helped me grow in my business. And as I grew in my IT career, and then I grew into my own business and scaled my business from a small India startup to some excellent work in the US for some of the top US banks. It has been an amazing journey of 22 plus years. However, I must also say that in this journey, you know, what I found is that as there was more money, more success, I had some great opportunities of in this journey, interviewing Dalai Lama, for instance, in front of 30,000 people, doing some great workshops. As I was doing my IT career, I was also always interested in facilitation training. So I got invited to do leadership strategy workshops at, you know, for the CEO and direct reports of GMR, Bharat Forge, Angel Broking, and several such companies. I noticed, especially as my business was growing, that somewhere my health had suffered. I used to be on a flight every night, every day, especially in the US, traveling like crazy. My spiritual clarity had somehow diminished, in the sense that I was getting more power by accomplishment and power by association, as opposed to power by purpose or power by wisdom. And finally, I also noticed that I used to conduct spiritual workshops on the weekend. I just felt very, very inauthentic doing that. So I had to do a lot of soul searching about 3-4 years ago, then decided to sell my stake in my tech company, which I had scaled up successfully. So it was a good move. and spend a lot of time just doing nothing, doing some coaching, receiving coaching, speaking to people, really encountering my shadows. And and I wouldn't say that the journey is in that sense complete, but after about a couple of years of sort of drifting and doing nothing, much more clarity and sense of purpose has emerged. And there's more grounding and better health and better relationships. One of the things I suffered the most was my relationships with my family. I couldn't give enough time to my daughter, my wife. And then I just had 4 years ago, I had my son born to us. So now it's very nice to feel that, yes, I'm finally spending a lot of time with family, as well as grounded in my purpose. Yeah, so that's a sort of a arc so far.
So, and how would you describe the, what I say, soil and roots beyond the tree and fruits? And how have your inner thoughts and narrative changed over time?
Yeah, I love the question about soil and roots. I think my soil is a traditional Tambaram South Indian family. Grew up in Coimbatore, and then I was born in Pune, but grew up in Coimbatore for the first 10 years of my life, and then back to Pune. The first 10 years in South India gave me amazing intellectual capacity, if I might say, some fantastic friends. And this was at a colony in Coimbatore called as PSG. It was a college campus sort of, and so it was amazing. But at the same time, there was a lot of superstition in Tamil Nadu. So I grew up, and I'm sure in India all over, but so I grew up challenging a lot. So I think why this, why that? There was a lot of deep impact about certain religious rituals and when nobody could answer my questions. So there was a lot of challenge in me, and luckily I had supportive parents who, you know, after my thread ceremony at the age of 13, I cut that thread and threw it away. Said that, you know, give me, you know, they didn't force me, luckily. So there was a deep yearning about who am I? What is this? What's the answer to this? I experienced some religious discrimination with my friends, against my friends, just because somebody's from a lower caste or just because somebody's, say, from a different religion. You know, my relatives didn't talk to them properly. So all of this left a deep yearning, deep rebellious nature also, if I might say. So a lot of interest in spirituality. And so at the age of 16, I went to Vipassana. That was great. And then at the age of 20, I met my spiritual teacher, who's my teacher even now. And then it has been a great progress and understanding of Advaita Vedanta, consciousness. So that is the main soil and roots, I would say. On the education side, it was also, I was a commerce student. So it was very easy to become a chartered accountant, right? So I still remember I passed my CA foundation at the age of 17 and a half. And they said, no, you cannot start now. You have to wait till you're 18. I was, I had the privilege of, I think, being one of India's youngest chartered accountants. I passed out at the age of 21. I was trying to get into IIM at that time. And I was, you know, and that's why I fell in love with public speaking and all of that. But my father's business suffered a lot of losses. And so anyway, I fell in love with also another subject called as EDP, computers in our CA. And so I never practiced. I just got into a software company at the age of 21. And it's been an amazing journey of scale, as well as learning in the whole technology field, along with this self-development meditation field I was always interested in. So these are the two kind of, you know, roots I can talk about and the soil. Thank you.
So I was reading your profile, and, you know, one leadership topic that stood out for me was egoless leadership. So I thought I'd mix it with my question of what are your core values and leadership philosophies, and where did they get built, and what does this whole thing mean for you?
So several insights on leadership got built as, you know, when I became a manager and then I became a CEO, and I had this, started this trust 20 years ago, the spiritual trust around the teachings of my spiritual teacher. Five of us started in 2008, today it's, you know, 20,000 people and we have branches worldwide. So it's been a journey of, you know, trusteeship taught me leadership, my CEO journey taught me leadership, and my tech career being a manager in a tech company, Canbay, which later became Capgemini, taught me leadership a lot. But two specific influences leading up to my philosophy. One influence was, there was a professor at IIM, I later on did some IIM MDP, management development programs. Mm-hmm. And there was this professor Sampath from Pune who passed away. I did this in IIM Ahmedabad. Mm-hmm. And he took us through Mahabharat. And he took us through how Mahabharata characters are can teach you so much about leadership. So that left a lot of deep impact about how Bhishma, for example, had a very impractical, in the name of vision, he had an impractical vision, as opposed to Krishna, who was very much practical in his approach to his vision. So that was one deep impact, I must say. And the other interesting impact from an organizational perspective was through Canbay. Canbay was this company I joined, and I was there for 5 years. The maximum I spent in any tech company other than my own company. And Canbay was set up by people who were part of Institute of Cultural Affairs. So, you know, Canbay's key focus was culture. And thanks to my public speaking skills, I quickly was able to, I got a lot of opportunities to present to clients, to be part of leadership meetings. And that is where I really picked up so much about organization culture, which both, you know, all of this and my own journeys and my own failings led me to this philosophy that leadership is primarily about three things. It's primarily about three things, which is vision, having a vision, but even before that, having self-belief that you can do it. And then you can, then you inspire people for that vision, right? So any process in the world requires three things. A process requires ground, it requires goal, and it requires tools, instruments, right? So for me, the ground of leadership is self-belief. The goal of leadership is vision. And the instruments, conduits, are people. So for me, leadership is just these three things: self-belief, having a vision, and inspiring people around that.
So, and tell us a little bit about the egoless leadership.
So you can have a personal vision or you could have an impersonal vision. And I think therefore, impersonal vision is the largest. I don't like to call it altruistic. I prefer calling it an impersonal vision. Great example is Swami Vivekananda's vision was universal Vedanta, right? So to give an example of how egoless leadership was born is that in about 2002, I shifted to the US for 6 months. I lived in Chicago. And I started, you know, conducting these spiritual retreats based on my spiritual teacher's work over the weekends. His name is Sir Shri. And then I came back to India and I said, there is amazing potential. Wow, this is fantastic. Your teachings can really take over the world. Happy Thoughts Movement should do this and that. And I want to spread Tej Gyan Foundation throughout the world. And he said that, he heard that and he said that, but that's not a vision. You wanting to spread your organization across the world is not a vision. That's a very personal vision. That's a very personal. You want to be a CEO or you want to spread. That's all very personal. You know, tell me what is the impact you're going to cause on other people. And, you know, that is what really led me to, oh, there is something called as impersonal vision, larger than life vision, right? So for me, egoless leadership, one of the most important tenets is that. Having an impersonal vision. And the other aspect of egoless leadership is also therefore, you know, really coming from consciousness, coming from seeing each one of us as, you know, connecting to that oneness, being vulnerable about our flaws. And so that's also a very important part of egoless leadership. When I mean consciousness, I also mean the quantum side of it, right? This whole observer effect and what science is today catching up on. And so really, can leadership therefore be not something that you set out to do, but as John Hyder says in the Tao of Leadership, it's an amazing book, that who you are is a midwife, who you are is a facilitator. And as a midwife, in the end, the mother and the child say, we did it. right? And the midwife has no role. So that for me is primarily, so have an impersonal vision and then be a facilitator, facilitating what is emerging. Yeah.
Very interesting. Let me take you back to your childhood. What was your biggest childhood challenge?
Challenge. Interesting. I think it is the same thing, which I mentioned, which is this lot of questions about spirituality and superstition, which did not get answered scientifically. Right? And so deep angst about that. I remember as a child, I once threw a pebble at a cat. Right? Patthar pheka maine, I threw a pebble. And in Tamil Nadu, my parents, more than my grandparents, they said that, oh my God, now you have to find that cat and you have to put a golden coin there where you hit the cat. Otherwise, your next seven lives is going to be really hell. And I, as a young child, had such a deep impact of that, saying that, oh my God, I did some crime of throwing a pebble at a cat, and kept saying, why, tell me how. And then get answers to that. So, and growing up more in Tamil Nadu, there was a lot of intellectual prowess at one hand, but a lot of superstition on the other hand. Also, I think was the biggest impact for me, which led me to this whole question of who am I, why am I, and what is the science behind all of this? How does it really work? Yeah.
So what have you found so far on how does it really work?
I guess, I think it's all just, you know, my belief around karma is that it is ultimately the impressions that you have on your subconscious mind. That's all, right? So if I copy in an exam, there is an impression that is created that it's okay for me to take shortcuts. And because of the impression on the subconscious mind, I might start attracting other people who are prone to taking shortcuts. And therefore, in my career, I might end up in jail. And then somebody might say that, oh, that is law of karma catching up. Because you copied in exam, you ended up in jail. That is just, for me, impressions on the subconscious mind. And then that kicking off the law of attraction and attracting those people and opportunities. There is no divine accountant keeping track. That's my personal opinion. Keeping track of my karmas. I think it's pretty scientific in that sense. And this whole morphic field of resonance. There is this, not only my mind, but there is also the universal mind. And we can attract opportunities and incidents based on our thoughts. Primarily, I think that's where it is. Now, if your thoughts are grounded in consciousness, it's great. Your thoughts can also be grounded in personal ego.
So would you like to share one or two more events which shaped your personality over time?
That's a great question. One interesting thing was about the power of communication, right? Just learning that I remember first time I went up on stage when I was, I guess, 13 years old, 14 years old. I was shivering. I was only able to remember what is happening in my legs and what is happening in my stomach, and that's it. And then I ended up with a bunch of friends as well as mentors who are into public speaking. And I really think and notice that when in my own life, just the ability to stand and speak in front of people and realizing that my stage fear is never going to go away. It's always going to be there. But in spite of that, how do you speak to people? It was very, very transformative for me. You know, this whole image of, I used to think that, well, I am this hairy, oiled Tamil boy who nobody is going to look up to, no girl is going to even think of me, talk to me. And I remember a very interesting incident at the age of 16, when I was 11th or 12th. And I was speaking to my mentor, who told me that your self-image, you know, as I was doing this public speaking, he said, your self-image is mainly a function of who you think you are. And at that time, the examples was that your personality is not Sunil Gavaskar's height. Your personality is not looks of Sunny Deol, right? Your personality is, you know, even Om Puri with freckles has a personality. Gavaskar with his height has a personality. So your personality is what is all that what you think you are. So I overnight remember very vividly sleeping and thinking that I have a great personality. All right. I didn't just thought. I went to college next day, 11th or 12th. And for the first time in my life, three girls complimented me. Krishna, you're looking great today. Yeah. So I said, oh my God. I mean, my sense of self-worth now is not based on what other people think of me. At that time, that was huge for me. That time it was all I did not change my, you know, hairy, oily hair. I did not change the way I was looking. But all I did was to just think I have a great personality and people complimenting you have a great personality. That itself was so, so, you know, deeply ingrained in me in terms of the power of thought and what can happen.
Maybe I think what I believe is you were emitting a totally different vibrations that time. Of being maybe in self-love in some sense, and that gets perhaps fixed by people.
Yes. Yeah. So that was amazing. And the other interesting incident was also in leadership. How if you really come from an impersonal thought, the whole universe almost conspires, right? So a vivid experience of that was in 2010, our foundation, Tej Gyan Foundation, wanted to organize a World Peace Festival. And me and another trustee got in touch with D.R. Karthikeyan, who was the CBI chief, ex-CBI chief, and he really helps a lot of spiritual foundations. So we said, you know, this is our vision. He said, yeah, I'm willing to help you. So whatever, this is our vision, we want to do a World Peace Festival. And we said, he said, I can help you. And he said, who's your ideal audience? If you love the Dalai Lama. So he said that, okay, next week Dalai Lama is coming in Delhi and can you come and meet him or try and, you know, he may not give you an audience. So we ended up at the hotel. And so, you know, we were told that you give us a letter and asking that you like to meet him and he may say yes or no. So I wrote in the letter, I had some friends in IIT, I teach at IIT. Delhi leadership once in a while. So I spoke to a professor in IIT Delhi and he helped me organize a printout. And I gave it at the Hyatt. And, in a few minutes of me giving the letter, he says, yeah, I'll come for your event. And I never met him. I just gave the letter to him. And he said, yes, we'll come for World Peace event. I will come for the World Peace event. And then, you know, the stream of just things that happened that, you know, we had to arrange a plane for him. Some industrialist in Pune immediately agreed to, you know, arrange the plane. And this World Peace event had several stalwarts and speakers. And it was just amazing how everything fell in place beautifully, including, you know, the tons of money that had to be generated for the event. Just everything fell into place. It was almost like I and other trustees were not doing anything. It was just literally a beautiful experience of just allowing things to happen. Yeah.
Very powerful. I think this impersonal vision is something which might be extremely useful for the leaders in the audience of this channel. And So I think a related question is what would you advise leaders to shift from, you know, I think a typical vision initially would always be personal and ego-filled. So how yes. can a person make a genuine shift? What will inspire the person to make a shift to an impersonal vision?
The big one for me is to really look at the deep impact on people. To give an example, there is a company I was mentoring called as MindGate. 65% of India's UPI transactions go through that company. And so we had this leadership workshop with their top leadership in Lonavala. And I asked them, what is your purpose? And, you know, we want to be a technology platform and a lot of things came up. So all I had to do, the answer was with them, no credit to me. All I had to do was to ask them, what is your purpose on your end audience? You are going to sell it to SBI or some other bank and they are going to give UPI to various other people. But tell me, what is it going to do in their lives? And so they themselves were able to see that their purpose is to create safe and simple transactions for everyone. Now, once you see that, that's our purpose. You know, defining a purpose statement is easy. I think that then the journey of how do you live up to that impersonal purpose is quite interesting and quite difficult. In my own journey, in spite of helping companies see this impersonal purpose, I myself went through a crisis where then I'd really sit down, rewrite my purpose. And today my purpose is that the purpose of my life is to help people all over the world awaken to the fullness of their being, right? So to come to this realization takes a lot of, you know, looking inside in terms of what is that unique impact that only I can cause on people. So if leaders answer that question, what is that unique impact I can cause at a massive scale on the lives of people, even in the B2B space, right? It could be for employees, for to really look at that and not just intellectually, but to really spend time. Yeah, I think for me, that would be the big.
So as you look at your life, is there any other turning point of your life beyond what you already shared?
One of the important turning points, I would say the most important turning points, is the spiritual retreat I attended at the age of 20, called as the Magic of Awakening. And this was a spiritual retreat at the Tej Gyan Foundation, where for the first time, the mind dropped. First time. And there was just consciousness experiencing and expressing itself. And just a little penny dropping moment. I remember dancing away. It was just so amazing. Yeah. I subsequently became a facilitator for the retreat, which also stopped some years ago, and I will restart now. And in one of the retreats I was facilitating, Vijay Bhatkar, who's India's, you know, creator of this Param supercomputer, he attended the retreat and he gave a lot of beautiful words to what I experienced. Till then, I did not have a scientific terminology. I was giving all this spiritual language of I experience, mind, consciousness, and all of that. So that's why it's also important. And therefore, that turning point was that just experience of no mind, which I keep going to in meditations. I wouldn't say I keep going to, the mind drops. So the scientific explanation he gave was that in science, for several years, there was this whole thing of is matter, wave, or particle, right? And then finally, finally, wavical, finally, they decided that it's both. It's matter or particle, depending. Look at it. And Dr. Bhatkar said that for him, his biggest dilemma was, is consciousness within me? Is God within me? Or am I in consciousness? Sometimes he says that I feel one with the universe. So then am I in consciousness or is consciousness within me? That was the biggest conundrum, similar to wave and particle. So is there local consciousness or is there global consciousness? What is it? And he said that he experienced in the retreat, which I happen to be facilitating again through videos and all of that. He said, I experienced in this retreat that I am both. Like matter can be both wave and particle. I am both local consciousness and global consciousness. So just hearing words for him gave me scientific words to understand and experience what I went through. Yeah, so that would be a very important turning point to really live that. Yes, I am local consciousness.
Yeah. So another part of the leader's journey would be handling failure, setback, and rejections. So yes. Can you give instances of any, you know, failure, setback, or rejection which you turned around in life?
Interesting. One of the earliest failures I can remember in my corporate career, I became a manager at a very young age. And for the first time, I was handling a team of people. And there was one guy whom I rated terribly in his appraisal. I said, you just don't do enough work and you just do time pass. And, you know, you really are not adding a lot of value. And so forget promotion. I'm going to give you a very bad score. right, in your appraisal. And then he asked me an important question. And he said, why did this take you 6 months to tell me? Why did you have to tell me during the appraisal? And I'll link it to one of the challenges I continue to have even now. And so that was that left. So that was very important for me, that, oh, the importance of giving feedback. But I think that problem continued in the sense that one of my greatest failures as a leader, I would say, is that for many years, I was always interested in looking good. In spite of this understanding of consciousness and all of that, you know, being liked was a very important value for me. Perhaps it is still, right? So as a trustee of such a large foundation, as a CEO of my own company in the US and in India, you know, I had a lot of trouble like telling people on their face that this is wrong, or what you're doing is not good, or this is causing negative impact. And if you do like this, you will lose your job. Right. So in my, you know, there are so many examples I can think of, not one. And that is one of my failures as a leader, where had I given feedback much earlier, right, the organization would have been very different, completely different. So, you know, so that is one thing that I struggled with. I am much more at peace with it after I took this break for the last 2 years and, you know, really looked at what is my purpose, what are my values in life. And so it's much better now. But that is my shadow. My shadow is wanting to be liked. And perhaps I will never be. I mean, the idea is not to get rid of your shadow, right? The idea is to embrace it, to give it a lot of and to be clear, that's not my shadow. That's my persona. My persona is to be liked. My shadow is that of, oh, I am bad and I'm unloved and I'm not loved enough. That is my shadow, right? And that is what creates persona of wanting to be liked. Yeah. So it's a journey of self-love where I'm trying to still embrace the shadow. I think it's a lifelong journey. Yeah.
I can totally relate to what you said. We call it being a goodist. I was reading a book where it was exactly like that. And you know, telling rather than few months later firing someone versus telling it earlier that if you continue this, you will be fired right at the first time. And I think I also added this part of somewhere I was accountable for coaching this person, what kind of coach I am that this person has not delivered. And hopefully I'll coach him to deliver and I'll transform him. Yes. So I got too attached to that person's transformation without him taking ownership of it.
Very nice. Amazing. Yes.
I can totally relate to it. And so now, obviously, all leaders go through a lot of turbulent times. You also have shared, and I really appreciate you. You know, you very openly talking about the shadow side. Most of the leaders probably either are not aware of it or may not want to acknowledge that very openly. So, what has kept you anchored in turbulent times?
One thing I keep telling everyone is that touchwood, I've not gone through a lot of turbulent times. Yeah, even on the financial side. Things were always towards growth, right? So in that sense, it's very late in life I realized that I'm too much focused on growth and I'm growing everywhere, but what about happiness, right? So touch wood, not a lot of turbulent times. But this period where I really felt, I have never felt depressed in my life. Thank you. Thanks to the divine power. I've always felt, I've been very optimistic. Things have usually fallen in place. But I think this whole soul searching of, I'm causing an impact in this trust, but I'm causing this, I'm running this tech company. It's growing and it's all of that is great. But I am feeling inauthentic. So for me, if there's any turbulent time, it was about 3-4 years ago, where I was feeling extremely inauthentic from inside. So much so that I stopped facilitating the spiritual retreats that I used to do over the weekend. Okay, you are not living, I used to tell myself, you're not living this. And if you are not living this, how can you even go and talk? Yeah, people come and attend and they say, oh, they have been transformed, all of it. I really feel shitty inside. So that for me has been, just that feeling of inauthenticity, which I don't even have gotten off fully yet. Right. So that was perhaps one of the most turbulent times. I would say feeling inauthentic in my relationships, feeling inauthentic in my intimate relationship, in my spiritual, my relationship with myself, in my spiritual growth. You know, these two things were really eating me from inside. Yeah. So, but I had great friends who helped me through it, great coaches. And so it was a relatively easier journey. Yeah.
Mm. Okay. So is there any ritual that you have followed over the years that have helped you? Any regular activity?
From a health perspective, for the last 1 year, I'm doing sun gazing. But going back to the previous thing, I think the most important ritual is that, I'm sure all of us have gone through it. Have you, Rohan? Which is to spend sleepless nights tossing and turning on the bed, thinking that, oh shit, what's going to happen? How will the future turn out? Feeling inauthentic and feeling shitty and feeling yucky, mucky. And, you know, have you experienced that? I'll answer your question.
In my case, I think only once in a while, like I can only remember one such incident, but most of the time I have still managed to go through the sleep very peacefully.
So the ritual that I follow is that whenever that happens, whenever there is something that troubles me, one of the rituals I've been following is, so it's not a daily one, it's more an event based
conditional ritual.
Yeah, not even it's event-based. Yeah.
Event-based.
Is to stay with it. Is to not solve it. Is to not escape it. As a CEO, this is what I will do. If this is the problem, this is what I will do. But instead, I've learned, and this has now become a ritual, that if I'm staying up at night, thinking, not able to sleep, because there's something that's worrying me, right? I lost my uncle to COVID a year ago. And my greatest fear, for example, was I shouldn't lose my mother. She's also diabetic like him. And, you know, what if something were to happen to her? And I was very scared, extremely scared that something should happen to her. And so every time that came up and in wave two, that it, in fact, it became even worse, right? Just looking at this happened for me in COVID wave one. So every time that fear came up, what I did is to just stay with it. I mean, I call it as staying in the fire of the feeling, to quote a friend of mine, Kiran, whom I'd love to speak to, staying in the fire of the feeling. It's about encountering your feeling and not escaping it, right? My initial response is, okay, let me shift my mom to Goa. Let me shift her to Dubai. Yeah, we'll do all of that later. But I am now going to just stay with that feeling, stay with this fear, stay with it and stay with it and stay with it. And the ritual is, if I stay with any negative feeling for 10 minutes without fixing it, it may come back the next day. That's a different story. Or sometimes just 5 minutes, sometimes just 3 minutes. Just noticing it, observing it, the feeling dissolves. Completely, it kind of, you don't have to solve it, it dissolves.
Yeah, this can be also a very, very central theme or a suggestion for leaders, that, you know, instead of avoiding or fixing. So these are the two natural responses. Instead of avoiding or fixing, be with it, stay with it. And I would think actually put an alarm of 10, 15 minutes or something and say, till that goes off, I'm going to be with it. And that is a very I've experienced this and heard it from few people who manage things very well, is is, and what you said is, you know, seeing it, noticing it from different ways, as if you are, you know, walking around some object, and a new object, and seeing all the faces of it, and where the light is, where the darkness is, in some sense. I think very, 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 very important practice which people can take away from this.
Can I comment a little more on that?
Yeah. Please go ahead.
What also starts to happen is that it reveals layers and layers of insights as well as things under, you know. For instance, in my mother's case, I realized that behind my fear, the bigger one was worry, anxiety, right?
Yes.
And beneath that anxiety, there is also guilt. I have not done enough.
Yes.
So the layers get only revealed with time. As I sat with my persona of being liked, and, you know, every time, why I did not give feedback, I just sat with it. The first thing it started revealing is that there is this shadow of, you know, I am not loved enough. As I spent about a year with this thought, with this feeling of I am not loved enough, and this feeling that, you know, constantly seeking love from my wife, constantly, you know, doing something to be liked, and, you know, seeking that being liked from your employees and all of that. So when I started doing that, the next layer emerged. It took me a lot of time, 6 months, perhaps a year, of that the actual shadow is not that I'm not loved enough. The actual shadow is I'm a bad guy. Childhood experiences where I decided I'm bad. I'm a bad boy. And just, you know, so as of now, I believe that I'm a bad boy is my shadow for which I put on a persona of being liked. But maybe there is one more layer I'll discover as I stay with it. I don't know. So far, I have come till I'm a bad boy. I was a bad boy. Yeah.
Very, very interesting. Okay. So any other parting advice you would like to give to a leader or a leader in making in the audience?
Wow, that's a great question. Parting advice for leaders would be that to very early on understand and practice the skill of deep listening. Deep listening is not listening to just facts, but I call it as three layers of listening: facts, feeling, and meaning. Listening to all three, verbalizing it in conversations is something that I wish I had learned much earlier, and that is something that I would and the corollary to that is to also then honestly speak your feelings. So both of that.
I think very interesting. It has been a really soul-searching kind of a interview. And I hope that it will set the audience really thinking on which stage they are in their life of leadership journey. And thank you very much for your insights, as well as, I think, for your authenticity while sharing your answers. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rohan. I think you create this wonderful, lovely space in which, you know, people open up. So all credit to you. You've been amazing as an interviewer. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.